Your word reminds us that the stone the builders rejected became the capstone. Lord, now, for the sake of your glory and the edification of these saints gathered in your holy house, please use this broken vessel. Decrease and he may increase, and may these words of my mouth and these meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
The world didn't end at 6 o'clock last night. No, it didn't. For the most part, at least. I actually, following that, that story with great interest, and I was fascinated to discover on the internet somebody from that group had been producing videos, kind of countdown videos from about day 14 down to the last day. I mean, they were very, very elegant videos, very well done. So much so that a rumor got around that actually a documentary maker had infiltrated Brother Camping's organization, was actually making a documentary about them. And I don't know, this is certainly very well made films. Somewhere this past Wednesday, I was watching a little bit of one of these things, and I was overcome with a sense of grief. And part of that, frankly, was just that Brother Camping, he's just a nice old man. He means well, and I really don't see him as a scam artist at all. I see him as someone who really believes what he's saying. And I felt sorry for him. I felt sorry for him because I knew that he was extending his life on something so horribly false. Somehow he had become deluded. This thing that he believed. And I felt sorry for those who were following him. And more recently as the events unfolded, or more properly failed to unfold, I found myself wondering if that's how Jesus' followers felt. Jesus' followers, a lot like Harold Camping's followers, gave up everything. At least his closest followers, at least those 12 disciples, 11 of whom became the apostles. They gave up everything. Why, there was one fellow who had a lucrative tax consulting business. His name was Matthew, and Jesus comes along. Jesus comes along and says, "Hey you! Hey you! Get you in the tax booth! Come follow me." And he said to these two other guys, "Yeah, you and you, yeah. You with the best of the fish. And they left their father with a pile of dead fish, and the boats, and the nets, and Zebedee and Sons Fishing Incorporated was no more. Or else it was just Zebedee Fishing." And so it goes. And they followed Jesus. They followed Jesus around the country. They put up with all kinds of things, and they were, there it was Friday night. There it was Friday. And their leader was being killed. Their leader was being crucified. And I wonder if on Friday after it was all over, if they felt a lot like Harold Camping's followers did come about 7 o'clock on Saturday. Wow. Wow, we are wrong. But there is a difference. What Harold Camping was preaching, what his followers were believing, was not the good news. It was not the good news. It was the bad news, or the good news with a lot of provisos to it. It was an attempt to scare people into a particular mode of piety. But an attempt to teach people about the Lord of life, the Lord of hope, about as much human sense as our attempts to bring peace at the point of the bayonet or the wrong side of the gun. And it works about as well. It can't ever work to teach people about the Lord of love using hate. You cannot shame people into belief. You cannot say to people, believe or else. Well, you can't say it. You can definitely say it, and some people may be in fear. Maybe just to get you to stop talking to them will agree. Our text begins, well, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he's just predicted that Peter will deny him. He has predicted his own death. And right there in John 14:1, he says what precisely?
Not
say that if Jesus was saying this right before the ascension. We know what the ascension is, right? Let's all write that in a week or so. Jesus ascends into heaven. But Jesus doesn't say this right before the ascension. If you look at it, he says it right before the what? Right before the crucifixion. Yeah. Jesus says this right before the crucifixion. So, I want to propose that maybe in addition to suggesting that, yes, there's a place for you in heaven, Jesus may be saying something else as well. Jesus goes to the Father. Jesus goes to do the will of the Father.
Still here. old song, a really old song, sung by Woody Guthrie. And I promise I'm going to try to sing it to you with a roll of Woody Guthrie. But the words of the song basically describe how it's an old slave era song, how no working man ever looks for the rising sun unless that rising sun brings judgment today. I guarantee you there are a lot of people who felt like that this morning, somewhere. Jesus, who says to his disciples, "I go to prepare a place for you." And Jesus, who says, "We are now in him. We are now in him, as I am the Father and you are in me." Perhaps Jesus is telling us that we are now the ones who need to be preparing a place. I submit to you there are a lot of people who are fearing. There are a lot of people who are afraid of the end. And I submit to you that it is our job as the body of Christ to prepare a place for them. A dear friend is angry, even though he's often angry. In some little way, we have to prepare some little place for him. The one who can't find a job, the one who can't figure it out, the one who's grieving over a loss. It's our job to prepare a place for them, a spiritual place, a place of love, a place where there is no fear. Jesus goes on and he talks about these things. He talks about these things. You'll notice there, towards the end of this lesson, he says, believe in me. It's the same thing he starts with. No, believe in the Father, believe in God, believe also in me. And he says, look, believe what I'm saying. I'm not a liar, believe what I'm saying. But if you don't believe me, believe for the sake of the miracles. After all, I made the lame to run, the blind to see, and I even raised the dead. Believe for the sake of the miracles. I'm really glad he said that, because that sets him above the false prophets. You know, Harold Camping, love him though I may, is after all a false prophet. And he said, believe in God. Believe that I'm speaking for God. There's not a whole lot he can point to. But here's the rub. Here's the point of friction. What sets us apart from that? I was thinking about that all through Friday, all through Saturday, as I'm watching the world not end. What makes me any different from Brother Harold? And you might be saying, well, first of all, because you haven't asked us to give up your life savings to go ride around in a minivan somewhere. Well, praise be to God, that's certainly true. But I think what might make us different, what might make those who are of the body of Christ different, the clue is found where Jesus said, even greater things shall you do. You can do even greater things. Now, if you're like me, that's kind of always scary. I gotta tell you, because try as I might, every time I try to walk on water, I get my clothes really wet. Every time we do have a few more people and we have communion and I threaten to run out of bread or wine, I'm thinking, okay, Lord, you know this bread multiplication thing now? Now would be a good time. I'm just not doing real well in the barrels departments. And unless it's something you guys aren't telling me, you may not be either. So I pondered this concept of greater things. I wonder what possible greater things could we do? And I came across a story of a miracle that maybe we could all do, or maybe we could all understand. And in one sense, I pray that we will never have to do this particular kind of miracle, but it is an example of an extraordinary miracle. This came in the form of a
a radio with you. You see, radio has power. It does. So I'm listening to this radio interview and I'm interviewing a woman who probably is in her mid-60s. And she was talking about her son who was killed by the gunman. They were people who, they lived close to the street. They didn't have a whole lot. Her husband had died. She had one son. That was her only child. The son was a young man. He was in his 20s. Still lived at home, tried to take care of his mom. We won't say he was a perfect young man. We won't say he was a good young man. We won't say he was a bad young man. He was just a young man trying to take care of his mother. Well, one night, and I know this will have a resonance for some of you on different levels. One night, he's out with his friends, and they're really not causing any harm. Maybe they're being a little too loud, as young men can be. They meet somebody else. They meet somebody else who is more desperate than they are by far. And a gun is pulled. And words are exchanged. And a shot is fired. And when the dust clears, this young man, this woman's son, is dead. The law catches up with the fellow who pulled the trigger. And he is sent to prison. The woman whose son died, by the way, is never called upon to testify. There are too many other ones. She doesn't need to be put through that pain. Perhaps mercy, she doesn't need to be put through that pain to testify. The young man is given a sentence of 25 years. He is in prison, and he's not doing too badly in prison in some ways. He's, well, it's probably the first time in his life he's able to learn anything other than kicking around the street. But the woman whose son died, the woman whose son was killed, she can't let it rest. She has nightmares about her son. She has nightmares about what that night was. She wasn't there. She never got to see him again. He left the house. Where are you going, son? I'm going out with my friends. Ah, the kid, he's always going out. Those the last words they exchanged. She thinks about this. Well, 9 years, and under the advice of her pastor, and under the advice of her therapist, and under the advice of her social worker, 9 years later, she needs to talk to the man who killed her son. And they talk. She goes, she talks. And she is angry. More than angry. And she wants to know why. And then something extraordinary happens. Something truly extraordinary. She gets to the prison. She gets to the prison. And she doesn't see a killer. Well, she does, because she's aware that this is the man who killed my son. She sees a human being. And they talk. And at the end of the conversation, they wind up embracing through the bars. The man is in prison. At this point, for another 5 or 6 years, and then he doesn't quite do the 25-year sentence, but he is released a little early, and he goes back to the old neighborhood. I'll make a very long story short for the sake of the hour, but effectively, this woman adopts this man, and he adopts her as his mother. There is profound forgiveness. There is a human example of the love of Christ. Greater things can we do.
we get past saying, this person can't come in because they're not the right religion, this person can't come in because they're not the right color, this person can't come in because they're the wrong sexuality, we recognize human beings, those for whom Jesus died, as the children of God, and we see ourselves not as less, but as what God made us to be. When we see ourselves as the living stones, as the living members of Christ's body who must go forth and prepare a place for a grieving world. Prepare a place for a broken world. Say to the world,